Good morning or evening, everyone. So I'm Shingo Yonezawa from Kyoto University, Japan. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for providing me this great opportunity to give this talk in this wonderful online conference, which I'm really enjoying. So today, I'd like to talk about the recent results on domain control of the topological pneumatic superconductor, strontium doped with bismuth selenide. So these are the collaborators of this work. So experimental study was performed in Yoshi Maeno's group at Kyoto University. And in particular, this strain control measurement was done by our former PhD student, Ivan Kostilev, who now moved to Okinawa. And a single crystalline sample of the doped bismuth selenide was provided by the Professor Yoichi Ando's group at the University of Kelun. I also thanked Clifford Hicks and Andy McKenzie's group in MPI Dresden, who helped Ivan to construct a piezo uniaxial device when he visited MPI Dresden a few years ago. So now let me start with a brief introduction of the pneumatic superconductivity in doped bismuth selenide. So I start with the explanation of the target material, bismuth selenide superconductors. So this mother compound, bismuth 2 selenium 3, has been extensively studied as an archetypal topological insulator in the last decade. And then this crystal structure consists of triangular layers of the selenium and the bismuth. And overall, crystal structure has a trigonal crystal symmetry with three equivalent axes here, here, and here. But in this talk, for convenience, we define x-axis as along the one of the bismuth-bismuth bonding direction, or along the a-axis, one of the a-axis, and the y-axis perpendicular to the x-axis within the AB plane, and the z-axis along the c-axis. And in 2010, it was found that by intercalating copper to this compound, this compound started to exhibit a superconductivity with a TC of around 3 Kelvin. And subsequently, so strontium doped bismuth selenide or niobium doped bismuth selenide were also found to exhibit a superconductivity with a similar TCs. And reflecting the non-trivial topology of the normal state electronic structure of the mother compound, so people believe that this superconductor can be a strong candidate for the bulk topological superconductivity, and that this compound has been extensively studied. And that indeed, theory based on the on-site interaction, but considering the orbital degree of freedom, so this theory predicts six different kind of the superconducting state as illustrated here. And among them, this delta 1a and delta 1b states are quite belongs to the even parity superconducting state, which is similar to the ordinary S wave state. However, the others, so delta 2, delta 3, delta 4x, and delta 4y, are quite interesting because they belong to the odd parity and the topological superconducting states. And among them, these are delta 4x and delta 4y states belonging to the two-dimensional EU representations are quite interesting because if you look at the gap structure, they have a pair of point nodes or point minima within the AB plane. This is a horizontal schematic horizontal cut of the superconducting gap structure. As you can see, superconducting gap amplitude exhibit a twofold symmetric behavior, although the underlying lattice has a threefold or quasi sixfold rotational symmetry. This kind of superconducting state with a rotational symmetry breaking in the superconducting gap amplitude is now called as a pneumatic superconducting state in an analogy to the pneumatic state in the liquid crystal phases. So now let me briefly review the recent works on the discovery and the development of the pneumatic superconductivity in this adopt bismuth selenide systems. So a few years ago, we measured the field angle dependence of the specific heat of the copper doped bismuth selenide. And this is a specific heat as a function of the in-plane field angle. And when the magnetic field is high and the sample is in the normal state, we do not see any field angle dependence of the specific heat, as shown in this gray curve. However, if we lower the magnetic field and then when the sample is in the superconducting state, so we start to see this kind of the nice oscillation in the specific heat. But this oscillation period is actually 180 degrees, not 60 or 120 degrees expected for the underlying lattice. So therefore, specific heat exhibits the twofold oscillations, as is clearly shown in this kind of the polar plot. So breaking the underlying rotational symmetry, of the underlying lattice. This kind of rotational symmetry breaking in the bulk and the thermodynamic quantities can be only explained if the superconducting gap amplitude breaks the rotational symmetry. Therefore, this result provides the first thermodynamic evidence for the pneumatic superconductivity in this compound. We also measured the upper critical field of this compound, and we found that the upper critical field also exhibits a similar two-fold symmetric behavior. So this result also provides additional evidence for the pneumatic superconductivity. And then considering the theory I explained before, so these results indicate that one of the delta 4x or delta 4y states are realized in this compound, and both of which both belongs to the topological superconducting state. And with a detailed analysis of the specific heat oscillations, we concluded that the delta 4y state with a point gap minima along the x directions is very likely to be realized in this sample. But this may be accidental because it later turns out that this superconducting pneumaticity may be strongly sample dependent. And then, so recent years, so there are many reports on the pneumaticity in the superconducting state of this kind of this class of the materials. And actually, before our work, so Okayama University group in Japan performed a nuclear magnetic resonance experiment on the copper doped bismuth selenide, and they found that the spin susceptibility in the superconducting state exhibit a two-fold rotational symmetric behavior. So this result indicates that the spin part of the order parameter is actually triplet and has a pneumatic nature. And as I explained, so our specific heat result for the copper doped bismuth selenide revealed that the superconducting gap amplitude breaks the rotational symmetry of the lattice. Almost simultaneously with our work, so resistivity study on the strontium doped bismuth selenide or torque measurement in the niobium doped bismuth selenide has been also reported. And then both studies reported a similar two-fold symmetric behavior. And more recently, so STM and STS measurement on the copper doped bismuth selenide was performed. And they revealed that the vortex core under the perpendicular field directions actually have a uniaxial elongation along the y-axis. This indicates that the coherence length is actually two-fold symmetric within the AB plane. They also measure the in-plane field angle dependence of the superconducting gap amplitude directly by using the STS technique. And they indeed found that the superconducting gap amplitude exhibit a two-fold anisotropy as a function of the in-plane field angle. So these results provide microscopic evidence for the pneumatic superconductivity in a copper doped bismuth selenide. And in these recent years, so there are many studies on the pneumatic behavior in the doped superconducting state in the doped bismuth selenide. And very interestingly, so pneumatic behavior has been reproducibly observed by using the different materials and from different groups, and also by using the different experimental techniques. So this is quite interesting and very strong for me to believe that this nematic feature is an intrinsic and a generic feature, properties in the doped bismuth selenide systems. But there is also some interesting discrepancies among the results. For example, so if you look at the direction with a large upper critical field HC2, which is probably very strongly related to the nematicity of the superconductivity. So this direction is actually strongly sample dependent. So some samples exhibit a high HC2 along y-axis, but some samples exhibit a high HC2 along x-axis. So this result suggests that there is some sample dependent nematicity pinning mechanism is there among these compounds. So I recently wrote a short review paper on this doped bismuth selenide system. So if you are interested in, please read this paper. And in this year, 2020, so more exotic results has been reported by several groups. For example, this group in Hong Kong reported that they measured the thermal expansion of a niobium doped bismuth selenide, and that they found that the spontaneous anisotropic distortion occurs at a temperature which is slightly above TC. So therefore, so nematic phase actually exists, non-superconducting nematic phase exists above the superconducting phase. And they interpreted this as a vestigial nematic order induced by the superconducting fluctuations. And actually, we are also trying to measure such a detector, such a spontaneous distortion in the crystal due to the nematic order. And then actually our student, Ryo Taniguchi, is giving a poster on this kind of the topic. He's now trying to measure the anisotropic distortion by using the optical strain gauge. So if you are interested in, so please visit his poster in the, after this session. And also Okayama University group in Japan recently studied doping dependence of the nematicity in kappa-doped bismuth selenide. And they found that this two-fold symmetric behavior in the upper critical field disappears for highly doped samples. And they argue that this may be due to the realization of the chiral superconducting state, which is actually theoretically predicted for the high doping. And then before closing this section, so I have to mention about the small crystal structure distortions reported in this class of compounds. And then X-ray diffraction studies on the strontium doped bismuth selenide by the Russian group reported some small triclinic distortions, namely the 0.02% in-plane distortion and the 0.005 degree inclination of the C-axis. And similarly, Newton diffraction study on the kappa doped bismuth selenide performed by the group of the University of Kelun suggests also some monoclinic distortions, possibly due to a small bismuth displacement as depicted here. Actually, they didn't observe a clear splitting of the peak or whatever, but they found that this monoclinic model gives a slightly better description of the result compared to the rhombohedral or trigonal model. So such a small crystal distortion maybe actually exists in this class of compound, but I still believe that it is very difficult to explain the observed large superconducting anisotropy by such a small crystal distortions. For example, anisotropy of the upper critical field can be related to the anisotropy of the Fermi velocity within the AB plane. But the anisotropy in the Fermi velocity in the plane due to such a small distortion should be very small and cannot explain the observed large upper critical field anisotropy ranging from tens of percent to the more than 100%. So very likely this nematic superconductive feature should originate from the nematic superconducting order parameter. And such a small crystal distortion may be serving as a pinning field of the nematicity, which I discussed before. So in the last half of this talk, I'd like to talk about our recent study on the uniaxial strain control of the nematic superconductivity in a strontium doped bismuth selenide. And this was performed by our former PhD student, Ivan Kostiev, and this result was recently published in Nature Communications. And coming back to the original nematic state in the liquid crystals, because these nematic liquid crystal phases are quite interesting because their direction of the bar-shaped molecules can be easily controlled by using the external electric field and so on. And this high controllability is a basic principle of the modern display technologies. And this infers that the nematic superconductivity can have a similar high controllability. And we know that so nematic superconductivity can be coupled to the uniaxial strain. So therefore, we started to study the uniaxial strain control of the nematic superconductivity. So demonstration of the such controllability itself is quite important and interesting, but also this kind of the result should provide important information towards the understanding of the microscopic pairing mechanism of this compound, or provide an important basis towards the future utilization of the nematic topological superconductivity as a novel superconducting devices and so on. Here, let me compare the macroscopic alignment patterns in the nematic liquid crystals and the nematic superconductivity. So in nematic liquid crystals, bar-shaped molecules can align any directions because the system has an infinite thermal rotational symmetry. So because of that, so the system direction of the molecules can exhibit the continuous changes in a macroscopic scale, and the system can have a very complicated structure as actually used in this kind of the liquid crystal displays. So they use this kind of the twisting of these nematic patterns, and this is very important to use this system as a pixel of the displays. In contrast, in case of nematic superconductivity, we have underlying lattices, so therefore, there's only a few directions are allowed for the nematic superconducting order parameter. And in case of this kind of the delta 4y gap, so only three possible directions are allowed. Therefore, such a continuous change of the nematic directions are not possible, but instead, formation of such a nematic domains are possible. So in case of nematic superconductivity, what we can control is nematic superconducting domains. And this kind of domain is actually very important, and because theoretically, so Majorana zero mode can be realized at the point where the three kinds of the domains meet. So this kind of the domain control can provide a new basis to study the Majorana physics. So in order to study the uniaxial strain control of the nematic superconductivity, so we use the piezo-based uniaxial strain device, which is a slightly modified version from the initial invention by the Clifford Hicks and the co-workers. But the basic principle is the same. So this device has six piezo stacks here, 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 here. And by application of the voltage to these stacks, so these stacks expand. And by using this expansion, so we can apply a uniaxial stress to the sample, which is placed at the center of the device. And in a device, we can apply maximum stroke of this device is around 16 micrometer, which roughly corresponds to the 1.6% strain. And for this study, we use a strontium doped bismuth selenide single crystals provided by the Professor Yoichi Ando's group at the University of Kelun. And the sample is cut along the one of the A-axis, which here called as the X-axis. And the strain and the electric current are both applied along this X-axis directions. And in order to control the magnetic field directions, so we use the vector magnet system, which consists of two orthogonal superconducting magnets placed on top of the horizontal rotating stage. So with these combinations, we can perform a very precise two-axis control of the magnetic field directions. And we align the magnetic field accurately to the crystalline directions in situ by making use of the upper critical field anisotropy of the sample. And here's a magnetoresistance data measured with several magnetic field directions and with and without a uniaxial strain. So first, please look at the data. Please look at the black data, which was measured without external force. And this is the magnet data measured with a magnetic field along the x-axis, and minus 30 degree, minus 60 degree, and this is a minus 90 degree, namely the y-axis. As you can see, superconductivity is easily suppressed when the magnetic field is along the x-axis, but the superconductivity is rather robust when the magnetic field is along the y-axis. So this indicates that the upper critical field has a two-fold symmetric behavior as expected for the nematic superconductivity. And the fact that the upper critical field is large for the y-direction indicate that the nodal structure is located along the x directions. So therefore, this results indicate that this kind of the gap structure, which belongs to the delta 4y state. So, and here I call this as a Y0 gap to distinguish from the other two possibilities. And this kind of the gap structure is actually realized in this sample. And by applying the relatively large strain of the 1.2%, so this resistance curve changes into this green curve. So as you can see, magnetoresistance curves have a substantial change due to the application of the uniaxial strain. So this is the first demonstration of the uniaxial strain control of the nematic superconductivity in this compound. And from the magnetoresistance data, we can evaluate the upper critical field. Here we evaluate the upper critical field with the three different criteria. So defined by the 95% of the normal state resistance, which is very close to the onset, and the 50% of the normal state resistance, and the 5% of the normal state resistance. And the upper critical field along y-axis, x-axis, z-axis are plotted as a function of the applied strain. As you can see, for all criteria and for all field directions, upper critical field exhibit a repeatable change as a function of the strain. So this manifests that we are still in an elastic regime up to relatively high strain of around 1.5%. And next, we focus on the angular magnet resistance. But before showing the data, let me explain the expected behavior in the case of the existence of the multiple nematic superconducting domains. And if sample contains only one kind of the domains as depicted here, of course the sample should, if you measure the magnet resistance near the upper critical field, resistance should exhibit, of course, a two-fold symmetric behavior, reflecting the two-fold anisotropy of the upper critical field. But if sample contains multiple nematic superconducting domains as depicted here, so this two-fold symmetric behavior should be altered by the six-fold behavior. Because once the superconductivity of one domain becomes weaker, other another domain start to exhibit a strong superconductivity and reduces the resistivity again. But if one of the domain has a larger volume fraction than the other domains, so the combination of these two should be observed, namely the strong two-fold symmetric behavior and with a weak six-fold modulation is expected in this kind of the situation. And this is a angular magnet, this is a magnet resistance data as a function of the magnetic field angle and the strength as a plotted as a color polar plot in this graph. And as you can see, this blue region where the super resistivity is close to zero, this region elongates along the y directions. This corresponds to this kind of the gap structure. So with a higher upper critical field along the y directions. However, if you look at the counter near the onset, you can notice that the additional peak appears plus 30 degree or minus 30 degree directions. So this indicates that the sample contains some part having this kind of the gap structure or having this kind of the gap structure. So these are 6 plus 2-fold symmetric behavior strongly indicate that the sample is in a multi-domain state with so very different volume fractions as depicted here. And then after applying 1.2% strain, so this resistivity data changes like this. And this additional 6-fold peak almost disappears. So this 2-fold symmetric behavior indicates that now sample is in nearly the single domain state as depicted here. So this data indicates that we succeeded in controlling the nematic domain structures by using the uniaxial strain. And from this magnetoresistance data, we also evaluate the upper critical field. And this is the upper critical field plotted as a function of the in-plane field angles. And with no uniaxial strain, this black data exhibit additional peaks plus at the plus minus 30 degree or plus minus 150 degree, which indicate the existence of the minor nematic domains. But as we compress the sample, so these two peaks gradually suppressed and finally almost disappears at the 1.2% compressive strain. This result indicates that so control of the nematic domain is not abrupt, but there's a continuous and a gradual suppression of the nematic subdomain actually realized in this sample. And to confirm this idea of the nematic domain control, we performed a toy model simulation. So here we consider this kind of the 3D network of the resistive element. And we have a 3D circuit of this resistive element consisting of the 12 resistive element. And to simulate a multi-domain situation, we assume that so one element has a Y2 gap and another element have a Y1 gap and all the others has this kind of the Y0 gap. And we calculate the resistance of this circuit as a function of the field angle and the field strength. And we evaluated the upper critical field of this circuit. And this is a evaluated, a simulated upper critical field near the onset for this multi-domain model. And as you can see, this is a black curve. So we succeeded in reproducing this six-fold sub-peaks located at the plus minus 30 degree and the plus minus 150 degrees. This results, it gives a good agreement with the data measured under, measured without a uniaxial strain. And also by replacing these two elements into, by the Y0 gap element, so we can also perform a simulation for the single domain model. And of course, in this case, upper critical field exhibits perfectly two-fold symmetric behavior. And this well agrees with the data measured under the strong compressive strain. So this agreement between the simulation and the experiment provide a further confirmation of the pneumatic superconducting domain control by the uniaxial strain. And in the last couple of minutes, I'd like to discuss the implication deduced from our result. So theoretically, pneumatic superconductivity and the uniaxial lattice distortion can couple to each other through the, this kind of the GL free energy. And here is a coupling constant, and this eta x is the amplitude of the delta 4x component, and the eta y is the amplitude of the delta 4y component. But importantly, this coupling constant is kind of arbitrary within the GL theory, and the sign, both sign and amplitude should be determined by using the experiment or by using the microscopic calculations. And in our experiment, we applied strain parallel to the x-axis, so this second term can be neglected. And the first, our result indicate that this y0 gap belonging to the delta 4y state is most stable under the compressive or negative strain along x-axis. So this result indicate that this sign of the coupling constant should be negative. And also our results provide some information about the amplitude of the coupling constant. Actually, initially before starting our work, so we anticipated that the uniaxial strain control of the pneumatic superconductivity should be much easier. But in the end, it turns out that we need a relatively large strain of around 1% is required to control the pneumatic superconducting domains. And this strain range is much larger than that is required to control the nematicity in the normal state of nematicity in the iron nuclide compounds. So this result indicates that the coupling constant G here should be relatively small. So this result provides an important constraint towards the understanding of the mechanism of the pairing mechanism of this topological pneumatic superconducting state. So for example, so any valid microscopic theory should be able to explain this small and negative coupling constant. So now, so let me summarize my talk. So pneumatic superconductivity characterized by the rotation symmetry breaking in the gap amplitude is now actively studied and have been found in the doped bismuth selenide superconductors. And we recently succeeded in controlling the pneumatic superconductivity, or more accurately, its pneumatic superconducting domains by using the uniaxial strain. So thank you for your kind attention.